So what I'm going to talk about is, so the panel is on manufacturing. I'm going to talk about services and essentially look at the role that services play as an input into manufacturing and the role that services play as a determinant of manufacturing productivity. Here we go. Next one, please. We don't have the speed of light here exactly. So just as background, you know, so why focus on services if what you want to know is what the impacts is on manufacturing? And the main reason is that services are inputs, right? So if you think about what do we think about when we talk about services? We're talking about telecommunications, we're talking about transport, we're talking about finance, accounting, legal, business services. All of those types of services are used by firms when they produce something, right? So if you think about the cost function of a firm, what goes into those costs, a large chunk of those costs really are related to their purchases of services, which they need not just to produce their goods, but also to get their goods from A to B, to design their goods, to finance their goods, and so forth. So kind of as a first order principle, if you think about what determines competitiveness of a firm, what determines the productivity of a firm, how can we think about improving productivity of firms, you need to think about the services environment. And that really is what this research is about. So depending on what sectors we look at, depending on what kind of activities we're looking at, services can account for 40 to 70% of all inputs that actually go into production. So that's one reason to look at services. I think the other reason to look at services from a productivity point of view, more generally for the economy as a whole, is that services are increasingly tradable. So if you think about what could countries export, where do they have a comparative advantage in producing and selling products, increasingly those products can also be services, right? So the traditional notion that people have that services are the quintessential non-tradable type of product is no longer the case, and it's certainly not the case if you consider or if you define trade as also including foreign direct investment and the ability of services providers to move to the location of a customer and provide those services. So in that sense, almost all services have become tradable, so it's also a potential export. So that means we have the standard gains from trade associated with services and the services economy. But the other kind of distinguishing feature about services is that they tend to be labor intensive, right? So technology is certainly playing a role in services sectors, but on average, you know, if you want to get your hair cut, you're still going to have one person cutting your hair, maybe more than one. And although there have been robots developed that you can actually get your hair cut where your hairdresser is sitting in another country, you know, that's still pretty much in the realm of science fiction, and it's not exactly cost effective. So I think we do need to think about trade, therefore, and trade barriers and services, and that's the other dimension of the research I'm going to present. What that does, it asks the question, so what is the impact of barriers to trade and investment in services on the performance of services sectors, and then how does that feed through into the sectors that actually use services? So much of my talk is going to be to look at the input function of services and various dimensions of what might determine productivity of services, and then indirectly how that affects downstream sectors, especially manufacturing and export performance. Next slide, please. I should have taken a printout of this with me, but okay. So here's kind of the first set of results, and you probably can't read the numbers, but essentially so we did two things in the research that we did for the IGC. One is to say, let's look at all the firm level data that we have that exists for countries. So these are the World Bank Enterprise Surveys. There are about 130,000 firms if you add up all the data sets across all the countries. And essentially what we were looking at is to look at what is the effect of services productivity. So what is the effect of the productivity of the firms that actually provide services on the productivity of the firms that actually buy those services? So essentially we're looking at the link between services productivity and manufacturing productivity, and what the regressions show, and I just wanted to have this table here to show you what the different effects are, is that one, there is a very strong statistically significant effect between services productivity and downstream productivity of manufacturing firms, so that's really what the dependent variable is here, and it also varies significantly with the extent to which those manufacturing firms actually use services, right? Now, that's blindingly obvious, that's what you would expect, but at least the data is telling us that that relationship is there. So the more intensively a manufacturing firm relies on different services inputs, the more it benefits in terms of productivity performance if it's in an environment where services productivity is higher than in other countries, right? So that's the first result that comes out of these regressions. And indeed, that is the input channel here is quite important. Now, there's also, of course, what you find as we kind of complicate the model. If you just look at what is the effect of services productivity on downstream productivity, that's very strong, robust. But then if you start adding other determinants of manufacturing productivity into the equation, that relationship becomes less strong, right? So other key factors like managerial competence, capacity utilization, the environment explains, of course, a lot of the manufacturing productivity. But nonetheless, this relationship with services is still there, especially in terms of the firms that use services most intensively. Could I have the next slide? So that's based on the firm level data. Let's see if I have it in. Yeah, so this is just a graph then to show this relationship between intensity of use and how much these downstream firms actually benefit from more productive services in their economy. And that goes up. You know, the more you rely on these services, the better, the more that services productivity link makes a difference. Next one, please. So given that we're in Kenya, I just wanted to pull out some of the results for some of the countries in the East African community. And essentially, if you look at the elasticity of manufacturing productivity with respect to services productivity, so this relationship between the performance of services and the performance of manufacturing firms in the country, you see that there's quite a bit of variation in terms of that link across the East African community countries. But on average, it's not that much different from what we see in the world average in the sample of firms that we have. So the biggest effect in terms of this link between services productivity, manufacturing productivity, according to the analysis, is in Tanzania and in Uganda, and it's much lower in some of the other countries in the EAC. But I think the big takeaway for us when we were writing this paper and seeing these results is, to us, this seems pretty low, right? So this relationship seems to be rather weak, and it's quite notable that we have that relationship not just for the East African community, for African countries. We find that across the board in these firm-level enterprise data. And to us, that suggests that really the data that we really want in terms of services input use are not really in these firm-level surveys, right? So, and I'll come back to that, but that's really one of the big research, I think, implications for further research coming out of this. We need to do a better job at actually characterizing the dependence of manufacturing firms, but also firms in the agricultural sector, on specific services. Next slide, please. So that was the firm level analysis. You can also then look at, okay, we have this link between services productivity, downstream manufacturing productivity. That should then feed into export performance, and indeed you get that out of the data. So there is a direct link, a statistically significant link between more productive manufacturing firms and greater exports. But again, the numbers are relatively small, and again, that's explained by this, I think, these relatively low productivity effects. Next slide, please. So that was the firm-level data. The other part of the research looks at what are the effects of trade barriers. And again, here the hypothesis is if countries that have high barriers to trade in services are going to have less competition on service markets, that's going to result in less productive services sectors overall. And that means that the manufacturing firms in an economy are going to have less good access to different types of services, so therefore they should be doing less well in terms of productivity performance. In a sense, what you're doing is you're taxing those firms by having very high barriers to trade. This is a slide that summarizes a recent exercise that was done in the World Bank to actually kind of characterize the restrictiveness of services policies. Essentially, it looks at how much discrimination is there against foreign firms' ability to actually provide services in markets. And what you see is that, one, there's quite a bit of variance across different sectors in terms of the levels of restrictiveness across countries. But you also see that some sectors tend to be much more restricted than other sectors, right? So in the gray bars here, which are the highest ones, are professional services. That has dropped off this particular slide. But the most restricted sectors in most countries tend to be professional services and transportation services, right? So, and then if you think about, those are both sectors which are important in terms of being inputs into the production of manufacturing firms. So the hypothesis is then higher barriers to those types of services are going to feed through these indirect channels of services performance and then to manufacturing. Next slide, please. This is just for the EAC, just to give you a picture of what services trade restrictiveness looks in this particular region. I've put Ghana in here, the red line, as the country in Africa that has the lowest average level of services trade restrictiveness. So what you see is that there isn't that much variation across the EAC, and there isn't that much difference between the average level and the best kind of performer in terms of this particular indicator. Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania tend to be a bit more restrictive than Burundi and Rwanda, but again, it's not, you know, there's not huge differences here. Next slide, please. So what we then did is we said, okay, let's try and assess to what extent bilateral trade in goods, right? So here again, we're talking about manufactured products. To what extent does the trade performance of countries depend on their services trade policies, right? So again, and implicitly here, there is a story, there is a model that says, well, because the manufacturing sector uses services, if we restrict services trade, we should see that being picked up in terms of manufacturing export performance. And in fact, we do find that, right? So in the first column of this regression results, you see that overall, there is a negative relationship between the services trade restrictiveness index and manufactured goods, merchandise goods, export performance, right? And that's kind of what you would expect. So that does come out of this data. If you unpack that services trade restrictiveness, it turns out that what matters most is foreign direct investment, right? So in services speak, you have mode one and you have mode three. If you only look at restrictions that affect cross-border trade, it is negative, but it's not really statistically significant. So this result of the negative impact of services trade restrictions on services performance and therefore manufactured export performance, really the channel through which that works is through foreign direct investment, through mode three. The other thing that comes out of the research is we said, well, obviously you also need to control for trade policy with respect to goods, right? So we're looking at exports of goods, so we should control for the trade policies that apply to goods. And that is something that comes out also as being very strongly significant as a determinant of a trade performance, which is something you would expect. Next slide, please. Let's skip this one in the interest of time. That was sectoral. So I think one of the takeaways from the research is we have this pretty big disconnect between the conclusions you get from analysis based on firm-level data and the analysis you get from using trade data and looking at the effects of these trade restrictions. So the way I interpret this difference is that the trade regressions, the gravity model kind of regressions that look at what are the effects of services trade restrictions on trade flows, is really capturing much more, I think, of the potential that exists for actually increasing the productivity of services as a channel to improve manufacturing productivity than we're getting from the firm level data. There's some related work that we've been doing, which is still underway, which tries to unpack this result of the strong relationship we find between high barriers to trade in services and manufactured exports performance. And it turns out that that is very heavily conditional on economic governance, right? So this result that we find that if you reduce services trade restrictiveness significantly, that it has a big positive effect on manufactured exports, that only is the case if you're operating in an environment with pretty good economic governance, whether it's the rule of law, whether it's control of corruption, whatever measure of governance you use. So the countries that have good economic governance, the implication is countries with good economic governance are going to benefit much more from an open services trade regime in terms of these productivity effects, in terms of the downstream effects on trade, than countries with bad economic governance. And that comes out very clearly and robustly from the data. Next slide. So just to conclude, Services matter for competitiveness. That was really the initial kind of premise of all of this research. And I think it is an important point to bear in mind, which has strong policy implications. Because if you're seeking to develop the manufacturing sector, you know, there is a lot of talk and, of course, a lot of emphasis on different types of industrial policies. But I think one element of that type of policy really should focus on the services sector, right? Because all of these services are inputs. And if you're in an environment where firms don't have access to productive services inputs, then no matter what else you're doing in terms of trying to promote industrialization or manufacturing activity, is not going to have anywhere near the effect you would have if you do, if you also focus on services. Lowering barriers to trade and investment to services has both direct benefits in terms of exports of services, which was not the subject of this particular paper. Here we're really focusing on manufacturing. But there is a very clear relationship between high barriers to trade and investment in services and manufacturing goods performance. Now, I think the big issue area for research here is to unpack these types of results, right? So we have this result that the services trade restrictiveness effect is very much conditional on the economic environment. And no matter what you throw into these regressions in terms of economic governance, it all gives you the same result, which is not particularly useful from a policymaking perspective, because essentially it says you should continue to do what you've been doing, which is to improve economic governance, which of course is nothing that I would disagree with. But I think if you want to go a bit further and say which sectors matter most in terms of services, which particular sector-specific policies matter most, I think that's where there's still a lot of research to be done, and that's not really picked up in a lot of this analysis. So the other implication that we conclude from the analysis is that we really need to do a much better job in terms of firm-level data on services use, right? And I think one of the reasons, and again, this is just a hypothesis, why we're finding relatively small effects in terms of services productivity links with manufacturing productivity is that we're really not picking up services activity very well in these firm-level surveys. So let me stop there. Thanks.
So, like many here, I'm personally very interested in understanding how international trade can be used to facilitate growth and development, particularly in African countries and particularly East African countries. And as will be clear shortly, this talk is going to differ from Professor Hookman's in two respects. This talk is going to be focused very much on a specific context, namely that of Rwanda, but hopefully I will make it clear, or it will be clear, the degree to which my conclusions can be generalized to other low-income countries, to other African countries, and to other landlocked countries. And then secondly, also because I'm going to be following carefully my notes in order to make sure that I do a good job of keeping time while still getting all my points across. Over the past decade, much has been achieved in trade negotiation within the East African community. And while I'm going to have some recommendations, particularly for Rwanda, about how to push this a bit further, it's worth acknowledging what's been achieved thus far. So the creation of a common external tariff has been the first step towards regional market integration, and it has been an important step. The next steps will be further integration of the economies through easier transit at the borders, and eventually the elimination of customs and border crossings, as well as harmonization of regulation and standards throughout the East African community. So let me start by stating the main points of my talk, both to give a framework for those of you to handle the rest of my talk, and as well perhaps for some of you to give you the opportunity to pay attention for the next minute, and then if you are a bit sleep deprived, to rest your eyes for the rest of the talk, which I can see that you will be allowed to do now, because in contrast to this morning, the cameras are no longer on the audience. So, but we have seen that Rwandan exports have expanded considerably under the EAC. While these exports have expanded, they've remained largely concentrated in coffee, tea, and minerals. And what would be helpful from the Rwandan perspective would be further diversification. So certainly services exports are important, but so are manufacturers' exports, particularly labor-intensive manufacturers such as apparel. And while exports are important, for many reasons that are well known to those in this room, imports are less well studied, but are also important, particularly in a low-income context like Rwanda or Burundi, other African countries. Exports are typically concentrated in a few sectors, and therefore exports only immediately benefit primarily those sectors. However, most sectors are dependent on imports, and so the benefits to facilitating import trade are typically very broad-based. In addition, as we'll shortly see, most exporters are also importers. As a result, I wanted to study the constraints that are facing importers. And while some of these constraints are obvious, such as transport costs, some are less so, and will only come out in interviews with firm owners. So I interviewed 23 firms in Rwanda in a variety of sectors, all of them firms that do at least some direct importing, in order to better understand the constraints that they face in their importation. I will share some of the major constraints that they faced and some suggestions to facilitate their imports, as well as to reduce trade costs more generally. But first, let's start with exporting. Most studies of export market dynamics have been based in middle and high income countries. For example, in Colombia, it was found that nearly half of all Colombian exporters were not exporters in the previous year. Most new exporters are small, and most don't continue exporting in the following year. In short, there are many firms that experiment with exporting, but the bulk of exporting does come from a set of large, stable exporters. Next slide, please. In Rwanda, exports have been expanding in real terms over the past decade. While exports did drop off in 2009 and 2010, immediately after Rwanda joined the EAC, Common External Tariff, this was due to the global recession, and not from Rwanda joining the EAC, as the subsequent export growth has made clear. Next slide, please. We also see that the Rwandan case is not that different from the Colombian case in a couple of respects. There are new exporters that enter into exporting each year. Those are represented in this graph by the export height of the blue bars over the past decade. But the bulk of export growth, represented by the red bars in this diagram over the past decade, the bulk of the export growth has been coming from, the stable and experienced exporters. Next slide, please. As I mentioned, while imports are important throughout all sectors of the economy, exports are concentrated in a few sectors. However, what we will see is that when we make things easier for importers, we are also helping exporters. So if I split exporters into two groups, one group that imports more than 10% of the value of their exports, and one that imports less than this or not at all, in this slide, the group that is a significant importer are the blue bars, and the value of their exports represented by the height of the blue bars over the last decade. So we see that the most of the export growth has been from firms that do a significant amount of importing. And so next slide, please. In fact, if I lower the threshold, so instead of looking at exporters who import 10% of the value of their exports, instead firms that import any value of imports at all, we will see that virtually all of the export growth in Rwanda has come from firms that do at least some importing. And so anything that aids importing will also assist exporting firms, although certainly in differing degrees. Next slide, please. We see that over the past 10 years, the bulk of export expansion in Rwanda has been to non-EAC countries rather than EAC countries. Of course, it is worth remembering that prior to the common external tariff of the EAC, Rwanda had largely tariff-free imports from all of the EAC countries with the exception of Tanzania. So the biggest change under the CET for Rwanda was the addition of Tanzania. the other countries having tariff-free access under CAMESA. Next slide, please. When we look at what Rwanda has been exporting, we see that it has continued to be concentrated largely in the coffee, tea, and mineral sectors. We see that there are two large bars in both the table, on the figure on the right, the figure on the left, and the figure on the right. The figure on the left, the first bar of vegetables, includes coffee and tea, and the second large bar is minerals. And we see that those dominate exports both pre and post DAC. Now, as we know, regional trade agreements are not strictly trade liberalizing. They liberalize the trade between the partners of the regional trade agreement while maintaining the barriers with the outside world. In many cases, this still benefits the parties involved. However, for smaller market and lower income countries, one concern of regional trade agreements is the potential for agglomeration effects to shift manufacturing that did occur in the smaller country, say Rwanda, to the larger or higher income country, say Kenya or Tanzania. Next slide, please. When we look at the manufacturing sector within Rwanda, we see that it has been fairly stagnant over the past decade. On the one hand, one might say, well, that's good. The manufacturing sector has kept pace with Rwandan growth over this period. Next slide, please. But on the other hand, there is reason for vigilance, as highlighted by this figure. So this figure uses data from all countries of the world that is available across time, and it shows the pattern that countries go through as they increase their income. We can say with 95% confidence that the pattern that a country will go through lies between the two dashed lines. So another way of saying the same thing is to say that virtually all currently developed or upper middle income countries have reached at least 18% of their economy coming from manufacturing. Now, Rwanda may turn out to be the exception to this rule, but let's look at why manufacturing has been important. Typically, manufacturing has been used as a means to climb the capabilities ladder, starting with labor-intensive apparel manufacturing and then increasing the sophistication of manufacturers and of exports as skills and knowledge have accumulated in the country. So the key importance of apparel manufacturing is shown in the next slide. So next slide, please. Here we see similarly the pattern that the apparel sector has gone through using data from all countries of the world over time. And again, the share of apparel of the apparel sector in the workforce will, with 95% confidence, lie between the two dashed lines. Another way of saying the same thing is that all currently developed or upper middle income countries have had at least 1% of their workforce in apparel manufacturing at some point. Again, there's nothing magic about apparel. It just is a labor-intensive, low-skill form of manufacturing with broad demand. So, what can be done to facilitate manufacturing, and in particular, manufactured exports? As long as it costs $4,000 US to ship a container between Rwanda and either Mombasa or Dar, manufactured exports will be limited. So, anything that reduces trade costs will encourage manufactured exports. And many of these measures will also benefit importers. So aside from trade costs, trade facilitation measures can also benefit both import and export trade. So some of these measures, trade facilitation and trade cost measures, will benefit both importers and exporters, and some will benefit importers more, remembering that exporters are also importers. We have certainly seen a number of improvements under the EAC. So customs infrastructure has improved considerably in Rwanda over the past decade. This was clear from my interviews with the firms, where with only one exception, there was little complaint about customs procedures at the border. Second, non-tariff barriers have also improved, particularly along the Northern Corridor. A previous paper by Jim DeMello and co-authors for the IGC was able to frame clearly and carefully the issue that the government was aware of and highlight the priority barriers to be eliminated. As a result, the number of way bridges have been significantly reduced along the Northern Corridor. And the importers that I spoke with highlighted that these issues are still present along the Central Corridor, and as a result, at least one importer chooses the Northern Corridor explicitly for this reason. So while the EAC has a common external tariff, it is not yet a customs union, at least not in the traditional sense. There are still customs offices at each of the border crossings where tariffs and duties must be paid. In an effort to move the EAC in the direction of a customs union, Rwanda has introduced a single customs window at Mombasa, allowing for full clearance of Rwandan customs at the port so that trucks do not need to stop at the Gatuna border crossing. And a couple of the more sophisticated importers were particularly excited about this development. Similarly, the electronic single window has also made customs clearance much easier for importers. So, what issues remain for importers? When a shipment of imports arrives in a country, there are several questions that customs offices want answered. First, is the product what it says it is? Second, is the price and quantity of the product correct as reported? Third, does the product conform to the importing country's national health, quality, safety, and environmental standards? To ensure that the answer is yes to each of these questions, countries either engage in a destination inspection, or DI scheme, where the imports are examined carefully upon arrival at the border, or a pre-shipment inspection, PSI scheme, where imports are examined at the port of embarkation or even at the factory of production. Next slide, please. This table outlines, and I apologize that it will not be fully visible, for a selected group of African countries where they engage, whether they engage in destination inspection or pre-shipment inspection. The important thing is that each of the East African, at least for my talk, is that each of the East African countries engages in pre-shipment inspection. This is good because it can take advantage of the fact that some companies, actually mainly four companies worldwide, specialize in pre-shipment inspection and can do it more efficiently across a wide range of countries than the importing country can. This can potentially reduce verification costs. And this approach is particularly relevant in contexts where there are problems of corruption in customs offices, as it removes the decision-making from these offices. It turns out that in the Rwandan case, this pre-shipment inspection remains the primary problem faced by importers, at least from my interview with a handful of them. 11 of the 23 importers that I spoke to identified some significant difficulty in importing, and three of them raised the problem of this pre-shipment inspection, or in the Rwandan terminology, IPCA, Import Product Conformity Assessment. The issue is this. For Rwanda, there is currently a single firm, SGS, responsible for pre-shipment verification. Importing firms have experienced considerable delays in trying to get import inspection and verification completed by SGS. I know that the Rwandan government is aware of this problem and working on a solution to it, and I would encourage them to follow through on this as quickly as possible. So each of Kenya, Tanzania, and Uganda have two other companies, in addition to SGS, that can perform pre-shipment inspection. The problem is the usual monopoly problem. If SGS is facing import verification orders from, say, Kenya and Rwanda, it will complete the Kenyan order first. If it doesn't, the importing firm from Kenya will choose a different import verification firm other than SGS next time around. In Rwanda, firms don't have a choice. SGS knows this, and so it will delay import verification services for Rwanda if it has competing orders. So the simplest solution for Rwanda, which the government is working on and should complete soon, I hope, is to contract with multiple firms so that importing firms have a choice of which company to go with. Another solution that would solve the problem for the importing firms, at least that I spoke to, but is probably not as beneficial to a wide variety of firms, would be to increase the exemption limit for pre-shipment inspection from $1,000 US to $5,000 US. So that would benefit importers and, by extension, those exporters that also import. But what is the biggest problem that remains for the landlocked countries, and in particular for Rwanda? Trade costs. Again, mentioning that currently one-way shipping costs between Kigali and either Mombasa or Dar ports are roughly $4,000 US just for the shipping. So in this context, the long-term returns from investing in a railroad are very clear. Next slide, please. This will be particularly important if Rwanda is going to rise along the rungs of the value-added ladder in manufacturing. To put the challenge for Rwanda and also Burundi in perspective, here is the list of landlocked countries of the world. Clearly, some of them have very high income, the red countries, and several others are also middle-income countries. Those are the blue countries. Next slide, please. Now, here's the list of landlocked countries that do not have railway access to a port. The average per capita income of the countries that do not have railway access to a port is roughly the income level of Chad. The average per capita income of countries that have railway access to a port, in contrast, is 60 rungs higher on the international ladder, so roughly that of Cyprus. Now, this is obviously not to say that building a railway causes income to increase 60 rungs of the ladder. There's been no randomized experiment that has forced some countries to have a railroad and other countries to not, so we'll never be able to say that. But in the context of massive shipping costs, there is no doubt that railways would reduce both the time costs, the hassle costs, and the monetary costs of shipping considerably. Now, the Rwanda government and DAC partner governments are also moving forward on this front, as it should. My time is limited, so I won't say anything more about the mechanisms for financing railways. From the Rwandan perspective, if there are roadblocks, so to speak, that arise in the construction of the standard gauge railway along the northern corridor, then Rwanda should push for a more rapid construction of the standard gauge railway along the central corridor. In the long run, it would be helpful that the management of the Northern Corridor Railway is independent of the management of the Central Corridor Railway for the benefit of, at least for the benefit of Rwanda. In this case, competition is definitely good. Next slide, please. Normally, this is the point where I would restate my main points, but given that I have had so many of them, I will not. But let me just conclude by stating that we are increasingly finding in economic development that institutions trump everything else. Building up good government services as well as the rule of law and encouraging strong informal institutions are probably more important than everything else. And efforts made by the Rwandan and other East African governments to improve their institutions, both trade and other institutions, will definitely facilitate trade and development into the future. Thank you.
Is it working? It's working.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Well, thank you. These are two very different papers in terms of their approach, and I think they both bring their own value. I'm going to probably talk a little bit more about Bernard's, because we've been doing some very similar work, which we have designed deliberately to get around some of those difficulties that he was referring to about the nature of the data. But just to start with Garth's, I think you've got some really good granulated information from those case studies. We all know, I mean, we've done all these case studies, how difficult it is to generalize your case studies without being heroic. But you get patterns, you see patterns, and then these things become kind of almost self-evident truths, and you just, if you went on adding to your sample, you'd still come to the same conclusion. I think the one thing in your presentation which I have the severest reservations about, it is the assumption that PSI is okay, because I'm not convinced that it is. First of all, you know, we did a lot of work on PSI when I was at the World Bank. We did a study on it. And the fact of the matter is, although we couldn't write it there because we didn't have the hard evidence, the PSI companies, integrity of the PSI companies is not necessarily superior to integrity in the customs services. And there were specific cases that we got. in that work, and I doubt that's changed very much. The second is that if you are going to use PSI, then it has to be an intelligent use of PSI, and maybe those companies are not willing to do it, I don't know. It has to be part and parcel of a transition to a good domestic customs service. And the first thing that makes a good domestic customs service is the verifiability of all data because it's mechanized. You know, a lot of people were saying ASICUDA would be as good as PSI, given all the warts of PSI. So, I mean, we can have a debate about this, but I think it's not a coincidence, and I don't think it's a conspiracy that the trade facilitation agreement in the WTO is doing its damnedest to get rid of PSI once and for all. And I think that tells us, tells pretty much the same story. So otherwise, I find it really interesting looking at how you gathered the policy data. And just for Bernard's work, I know I probably shouldn't do this, but I'll just very briefly say what we've been doing, because it is services, and it's manufacturing-related services. We've had a study, we've got about 35 case studies. They are data free, unfortunately, because firms, the kind of information we wanted, firms, if they gave it to you, they said they'd kill you if you used it. And some of them just wouldn't give you the information. So we've basically tried to design the work to understand not so much how much, by how much, or, you know, to quantify these things, even though I like the approach. I think what you've done is useful, although I don't necessarily believe in the second decimal point. And by the way, those numbers are too small, and it has to be for the reason you gave. And I think that is one of the things that comes out of the work we've been trying to do. So basically, we've gone on to these different firms. We've asked them to define a value chain out of their multiple value chains. We've got around the general equilibrium, partial equilibrium problem by simply saying we are, for the purpose of this analysis, defining the beginning and the end, and we'll only deal with first-tier inputs. And so to start with, it's just a mapping game. It's a mapping exercise. But what really is this useful for? We use CPC nomenclature, so we couldn't be accused of splitting hairs to get a larger number. But basically, the number of services that these value chains use is enormous. You know, the making bulldozers, Komatsu making bulldozers, uses over 70 quite distinct services to do that. I told the manager who we got the interview with that, when we finished all this, because we also tried to get a sense of the share of value, that they were actually a services firm and not a manufacturing firm. He got very upset because they're very proud about the sort of manliness of their large, very large machines with huge wheels. But basically, we did that. Then we tried to understand a bit of the developmental aspect of this. This is in different Asian countries. We went around a lot of Asian countries we've got case studies from. We looked at outsourcing of services. And I was surprised to find out how ubiquitous it was. On average, services entering the supply chain, the value chain, 60% on average from a part of our sample were outsourced. And so we did a lot of work on outsourcing. Why do you outsource? Why don't you outsource? Who do you outsource to? And I think that this had real policy resonance, because you can then tell governments, we haven't written this up yet, but you can tell there are a lot of rich stories about what governments ought to do if they want more of the action. So that was also a part of it. And then bundling. Every arm's length transaction is a bundle. The question is how you shape the bundle and why you shape the bundle the way you do. And so we were trying to understand a little bit more about how the decision to bundle was made. But it was a limited exercise because we weren't getting too many third-party transactions given the way we defined the value chain. And clearly, some of it's product differentiation, some of it's getting market share, some of it's avoiding policy problems. So it's quite a rich set of stories there. I think one of the things that firms were surprised about when we sort of said, you realize that, because this all changed when we started measuring trade in value-added terms, by the way, the great insights on services came after the systematic efforts that were made to measure trade in value added. And you began to discover that instead of 23%, which we used to report day in, day out from WTO as a share of services in, in trade, it immediately jumped to up near, very nearly 50% when you got, you used the input-output matrix and calculated that way. But that's still an understatement. It's still an underestimate for various technical reasons, which we could go into. But so I think the understanding that service is a source of value, services as a source of development, services and the way you supply them and the policy environment you create for them being absolutely crucial for your capacity to attract industry that wants to be competitive. So the other thing I think that was that, as Bernard pointed out, not quite all services are inputs, but an awful lot of them are. But the fact is, if you're in a world of bundling, there is no input service, none whatsoever, that cannot be traded. They're more tradable than goods. And yet we always had this idea that services were this rump of inefficiency that was not going to go away, and anyway, these were non-tradables. They're not. The guy who sweeps the floor in the factory of a shoe factory that exports its shoes is exporting cleaning services. So putting all that together and trying to understand what governments could do about this, we've got some quite interesting policy stories, like Garth, quite similar. The interesting thing that we found in the Asia context was that the biggest single complaint was something that's really difficult to measure. It was the lack of policy consistency. That is what they moaned about the most. I don't know what's going to come down the pike. You tell me what's going to come down the pike and I'll do my best to adjust to it. But if you keep changing it and keep doing things that you're not supposed to do, I can't operate effectively. And so poor policy becomes a massive drain on productivity potential. And we try to treat policy a little bit like a productivity factor. But again, no way of getting the data, and hard to get the estimates because it's the case studies and it's just very difficult. But I think the policy consistency was the biggest message. The second biggest message was the factor markets. More problems in factor markets than in product markets. It was about investment. It was about the conditions for investment. It was about the conditions for work permits and all sorts of crazy stories about this. Now, some of this is quite sensitive because some governments want to make sure that there's equity, that they have that they control some of the equity, or their nationals control some of the equity. But sometimes that's just a fiction because it's controlled by somebody who puts the goodies, who doesn't participate in anything and then puts the goodies in the bank in Bermuda or whatever. So it's a tricky one, but I think one has to recognize that it's not, you can't say you shouldn't have equity requirements on foreign investment, but you should think very hard about why you do. After that, it's similar stories to Garth, I think, except that customs, and I know our customs is less of a problem in Rwanda, but in these Asian countries, most of them, they complained a lot about customs. And they blamed a lot about customs agents, which is another thing that the trade facilitation agreement is trying to get rid of, the obligatory use of agents. So they were a problem, particularly. Customs was also considered a problem from, at least in part, from the health, safety, environment, TBT, SPS. But TBT and SPS were consistently complained about as unnecessary costs. Systems run in an arbitrary fashion by utterly unqualified people. They're constantly going on about this. So I think that none of these things are, it really makes you ask, what is it that works, real policy changes? Not just the measures, it's the whole way. And I think an important finding, but I don't know what the hell you do about it. A lot of what matters isn't necessarily the nature of the measures, it's how they are applied. And it's the attitude of the enforcers. You know, in some of those places, you pay to get a job as in the government because it's much more lucrative than your salary. So that's sharing this. But I do think that the work that these kinds of both case study and firm level, but what is really missing in all of this is data, whether it's policy data, whether it's production data. And I think a huge push on the data front is something that would yield enormous dividends.
I wonder if I could just ask Sally or Amanda to check and see what time this session is supposed to end, because at some point we're going to get kicked out, and it would be nice to know that. Before I turn over, 20 minutes, okay. Thanks very much, Patrick. I think you've opened up a very interesting set of agenda. I turn over the questions to the audience. Bear in mind, we'd really like your input into this, particularly any disagreements or objections to some of the analysis that's been put forward. Let me ask a question of the panel, and actually, including Patrick. You know, Patrick is Kenyan, so he knows the East African community very well, in spite of the fact he's been talking about Asia. But I wondered, I'd just like to ask the panel, going back to the issue of policy consistency, what kinds of policies do you see within the region that ought to be changed to promote services integration? You know, we have across the EAC, for example, quasi-monopolies in the telecom sector in each one of the countries. How could those barriers to competition, be they regulatory or perhaps forbearance among the leading firms, be overcome so as to spur increased services efficiency and through that manufacturing efficiency? Or like trucking, for example. Trucking is another area that's crucial to Garth's findings in terms of transport. What issues in trucking could be addressed that would increase competition and therefore make manufacturing more competitive within the East African community? You want to take a shot at those questions first?
Thanks. Okay, so this is actually something that, of course, the EAC is actually working on, right? So this is part of the agenda for actually creating the common market. And it's not an agenda which is particularly easy. It's certainly, you know, other experiences. And if you're really talking about integrating the markets, that is something that is very difficult because you have to deal with regulation, right? So I think the first thing to do is to actually distinguish between things that are explicitly discriminatory, where you're actually preventing a supplier from another EAC country to operate within the EAC, as opposed to measures which really have to do with domestic regulation, and where the problem is we have differences in regulation and those differences create costs for firms as they go from one market into the other. So I think the experience certainly in the European Union illustrates that dealing with the regulatory agenda is something that takes a lot of time. It requires a lot of building up institutions, figuring out why we are regulating, trying to get towards mutual recognition. And that, of course, is the standard approach, which is actually being pursued in the EAC for in areas like professional services. But I would really start with dealing with explicit restrictive practices that segment markets, right? And I think there's a big competition agenda there, certainly in the area of transport, where, again, this is not something I've studied myself, but I've heard stories about how, in effect, the payoff towards all the efforts that have gone into kind of reducing the time it takes to get a container from Mombasa to Kigali is actually much less. So there's much more of a time reduction than there is a cost reduction, right? And one of the hypotheses behind why we haven't seen a greater reduction in the cost of getting these containers from Mombasa into Rwanda is because there is not enough competition in the transportation market, right? So we have that in road transport with trucking, but I think you also have that in air transport. And again, that's not something which is specific to the EAC, but I think there has been much too little of a focus to actually get to open skies, to implement an open skies agreements, to allow airlines to come in and to come out. So again, that competition agenda is a very important one. It came up in the previous session we had here, and I think it really is important here as well. I think the other thing I would mention is you also need to prioritize, right? So I think the two things that really come out of the research to date, and that also correlates with where the barriers are the highest, is in this area of professional services and in the area of transport, with a bit of transport telecommunications. But I think the professional services one tends to get neglected because, again, coming back to the theme of this panel, which is about productivity, one of the channels for productivity improvement, the knowledge to actually help management improve the way they operate the business, that comes from management consultants, it comes from accountants, the auditors. I mean, those are the guys Those are the services providers which actually help firms improve their productivity, right? That's the way it works in the EU, in the US, everywhere. So if you have very high barriers to that, the large multinationals can overcome those barriers, but they're not servicing the mass of the firms, right? So I think that is one area where you could have a big payoff.
I don't have much to add to what Bernard has said on that, other than that certainly given the size of each of the markets, that as they work towards integrating essentially all of their current regulations with regards to different services and with regards to transport, that's certainly going to make things more efficient. Instead, I'm actually going to take the fact that I've got the mic in my hand just to make a brief response regarding pre-shipment inspection, which, and I definitely appreciate Patrick's comments, and that I agree that completely that the integrity of the PSI companies is not necessarily stronger than it is for the customs agents, and particularly for this case in Rwanda, and that where there, so my first conclusion would be that if you are using PSI, then it definitely is going to be better to have more than one firm handling the PSI in order to make sure that there is competition, and that hopefully not just the efficiency but also some of the integrity can be addressed. And then I would also say that with regards to if there are contexts, as you were alluding to, where customs agents are being criticized for their ability to handle sanitary and phytosanitary inspections, then if there are going to be at least some contexts where the PSI may be better. But I think where the pre-shipment inspection can be advantageous is primarily on economies of scale. So we know that, for example, the U.S. has the scale to, for its imports, in order to ensure conformity with its standards, to inspect at source in a wide variety of different countries, and to actually have the, you know, the government agents from Department of Agriculture, et cetera, in a bunch of countries to ensure that the standards are. Clearly, East African countries don't have the same kind of scale to be able to ensure those at source. So, and I think I would also accept the critique that there's not as much of a benefit for pre-shipment inspection at the port of embarkation, but I think that there is a benefit for pre-shipment inspection at the factory, where it's easier to see exactly, you know, what the steps that have been gone through in order to ensure that certain standards have been adopted, and there are, you know, similar standards for a lot of different countries. And so I would agree that the integrity of the PSI companies is not necessarily stronger than the customs officials, but that if there is a benefit, then it is primarily through the economies of scale.
Yeah, no, I don't think we wildly disagree. It would just be the question of where this fits in to the broader context of development. And the idea that you're going to have 100% inspection has to go out one day, because all this is predicated on 100% inspection. On the other question, I think I don't think as much I can add to what Bernard said either. I mean, I see transport as the major problem, because you hear it constantly. And powerful interests own transport companies, and they are not about to let them be competitive unless there's, you know, significant decision.
Telecoms,
I find, you know, of course, one should be careful about making these sorts of comparisons, but I find telecom prices in Kenya pretty good. Not bad at all. Yeah. Put it in Swiss francs and see what. So I'm not saying that there isn't more room for more competition. All I'm saying is that they've done pretty well in that sector, and the Kenyan economy has been transformed by mobile telephony, and everybody can afford a little telephone, and they all have them.
Good, thank you very much. Just a little point on that. The IGC did a study of telecoms in Rwanda, and one of the things we found was there was a tendency on the part of the dominant firm to set up a pricing structure that kept the competitive fringe from having access to its large network. In fact, it was easier. Sorry? In Rwanda. MTN and Tigo. All right? All right? And the notion here was that it was very expensive to, sorry, I have to name names. It was more expensive actually to call across town to Tigo than it was cost for to use an MTN phone to call London. So eventually the Rwandan regulatory authority began to look at that question very closely and did take action. But I think there's more to be said on telecoms. And but before we go further into that, let's take questions from the audience. And I'll take a series of questions for our panel here in just a minute. This gentleman in front, and then we'll do in the back, and then over here. Please say your name and your organization.
Sure. Will Martin from IFPRI. Thanks very much. Great presentations. Really enjoyed it. Garth, on Rwanda, countries that are seriously isolated, you know, like, say, Virginia in the 17th century or Australia in the 19th century or Rwanda in the 20th, tend to have people looking around for what it is that's high enough value per weight that it can stand the transport costs. So in Virginia, it was tobacco. In Australia, it was wool. Rwanda, it was coffee. I'm wondering, I presume, people are doing calculations like that. Given this sort of enormous transport cost, what is it that can stand the cost of transportation? Maybe it's services, infinitely light. Electronic services, I don't know. But did you look at that question, or is anyone else, to your knowledge, looking at that question?
So certainly, yes, services are very light. Part of the reason why I'm advocating manufacturers as well is that at least all other countries have been able to use increasing sophistication of manufacturers to rise the capabilities ladder. And so as a result, you're initially looking for manufacturers that are both relatively labor-intensive, unsophisticated, and also, as you would suggest, light. And given that, you know, as I outlined, you know, apparel has been the major stepping first rung of the ladder for all of the other countries of the world, the highlighted question is, what's constraining them? And we heard in this morning's talk that at least one apparel exporter had 40% of their cost being the transport to the port. And as long as that is the case, that is definitely going to constrain, for example, for Rwanda, their exports.
Thanks a lot. Can we take another question back in the back?
Hi, thank you. Max Mendez-Parra from the Overseas Development Institute. This is a comment and a technical question. The first is a comment associated with the value added from services in export. It was mentioned that it is above 50%. Well, yesterday was mentioned that Trademark East Africa has calculated that actually 45% of the cost of a product is transport and logistics. So basically, yes, I believe that is more than 50%. The technical question is on the regressions associated with the effect of the different restrictions. You didn't disaggregate mode 4. Is there a reason about that? And if, in any case, if you can provide what would be eventually any effect of any flexibility in mode 4. Thank you.
A couple of other questions, if I can, just so that we can make sure several people get a chance to participate. Nick?
Thank you. Nick Charalambides, Imani Development. I think one of the, this is a reflection. I think, Garth, from your presentation, what came out clearly to me was the importance of firm. Who is actually doing it? And I think sort of your finding about large, generally foreign-owned companies driving exports is really a finding that came out from a lot of the enterprise survey work over the last decade. And I think that's important from a policy perspective, because we are increasingly being asked by governments to find sectors where actually what we need to do is find people who are good at doing whatever they're doing. And if you're looking at a key link between trade and productivity, investment, FDI, is critical. And guess what we're running away from? Investment and opening up. Now, I also think firm level consideration may be in part what is driving the low elasticity of services improvements in manufacturing. Why do I say that? Again, if you look at the average enterprise, it's 30% as productive as those on the frontier. This may be dated now. So services improvements are going to be concentrated on your best performing companies, which are low. But again, you know, so that highlights yet again that it is who is doing it, not so much what sector they are in. And our policies are completely behind. We are light years behind thinking about that. Thank you.
Thanks very much. We have another question here.
Thank you very much, Jody Keane from the Commonwealth Secretariat. I really enjoyed your comments, Patrick, regarding the case studies and firm level, linking the two case studies and firm level analyses. And it gets really tricky when you try to do that over time and thinking through in a value chain context. So I just wanted to kind of push Bernard a little bit, thinking about kind of what questions could be included in the enterprise survey, which is one of the best data sources that we have, actually, across countries and across time. What additional questions could be included in there to kind of adapt to the kind of new realities of trading in value chains? And it seems to me a missing link is this the kind of role of information services and thinking about the role of intermediaries. And, you know, obviously this is a challenging research agenda. It does require a bit of a different approach, mixed methods. But I just wanted to push you a little bit, maybe two, if you could just give two or three ideas, like what you really want to see improved in those surveys. Thank you.
Great. Let's just take it back in order. Bernardo, since the last question was directed to you, perhaps you can take up the agenda.
Okay. Let me take it from the top. So on why no mode 4? So there is a little bit of implicit mode 4 analysis because of the link to professional services, and that's really the only one where there is some information on barriers to that. But basically it goes back to what Patrick was saying, is we don't have the data, right? So it's really, there is virtually nothing on this. And I think really one of the challenges maybe for research, which I certainly haven't looked in, but if you think about maybe trying to combine some of the migration data with the services part, maybe there's a bit there, but ultimately you're not going to get it out of the data sources that we tend to use. So that's, I think that's a big open research agenda. On the point by Nick, I fully agree, and I think that is something I take the point. And I think that certainly the FDI link and the importance of FDI certainly comes out of the research in terms of what is the impact of these services restrictiveness measures on productivity. So that certainly confirms with what you were saying. In terms of what to include in the surveys, I think it really needs to start by unpacking this general notion of administrative selling expenses so that you actually have more of a sense, okay. And as Patrick said, I'm not sure how easy this is going to be in terms of asking them specifically about costs, but at least at the very least to get a sense of for two or three or four kind of basic services inputs to get a sense of what is the total share of costs that are incurred in terms of buying those types of services. So I think it's really just unpacking the cost side of the equation for the firm. And I think, yeah, and then we can get a bit more ambitious, so then we can also say, well, maybe try and ask questions about, do you actually source from foreign suppliers or not? You know, foreign-owned suppliers, is that going to have an effect? But I think that we need to start by just having a sense of what is the share of different types of services across different sectors, which we have in the input-output tables, of course. So essentially, it's kind of replicating what we have through the I/O tables to see where that fits in into the firm-level surveys. Now, I know there's been some work on this in countries that have good firm-level data. So, for example, for the United States, and I was at a conference a couple of years ago where they were trying to bring the national accounts people together with the people who do firm-level work. And, you know, that showed very quickly that there were huge inconsistencies in terms of the conclusions you get out of those different data sources. So it's not necessarily the case that the I.O. tables and the national accounts data are actually giving us an accurate sense of what these firms actually do. So I think it's a big research agenda there, clear. That's pretty clear to me.
Yes, the only thing I would add is I certainly agree on the importance of investment. In some other research that I've done looking at the African Growth and Opportunity Act, and in particular the apparel provisions under that act for importing into the U.S., that definitely the benefits of apparel exports to the U.S. came through foreign, largely Asian investment in virtually all the African countries where it was taken advantage of, and certainly that has benefited Africa in terms of employment and export growth. That's not the only source of exports, but it's an important one.
Yeah, just one to agree very much with the person from ODI. And that taking the lesson that, you know, having a high cost, high share of services in cost doesn't necessarily mean that services are important. It might mean that they're just really badly supplied. I think that is a very good point to make. But I also think that those sorts of numbers for transport are somewhat unusual.
So thank you very much. Our time has run out. I would like to just present four conclusions, at least my takeaways. There may be others from you as well. The first is the importance of services and services productivity in firm productivity throughout the economy, and particularly manufacturing. I think that's pretty strongly evident from the papers we've put forward here today. Exactly how much, exactly what the effects are, I think much more work needs to be done in that area. Second thing is the role of transport and professional services as being two key service areas where I think future policy effort could be made in order to, based on what we know already, in order to make it easier for landlocked countries and actually countries even like Kenya that have access to the coast but have also internal transportation costs that are quite high. Thirdly, the importance of competition policy and regulatory policy in this agenda. This is extremely complex. It turns out that the STRI of the World Bank is quite a gross measure of services restrictions. And I think one of the things that we have to do is sort of penetrate that veil of regulations, because I think it was Patrick that mentioned, did you say 70,000 services, did I get that number right, that were outsourced as part of the value chain in your study of East Asian companies? In any case, a large number of service, subservice sectors. Sorry?
50%.
A large number of sectors, a large number of services have been outsourced. The fourth takeaway I have is the importance of future research in this area. Clearly more data has to be gathered if we really want to understand the complexity of the relationship of services competition to productivity in manufacturing. One area which I think is really pretty important also in terms of future research is looking at outsourcing patterns. And, you know, going back to coast, I think if you have very large markets, it's much easier to outsource because you can take, you have available to you architectural firms, legal firms, and so forth. This goes also to the importance of scale induced by regional trade agreements and the importance of professional services. We need to know much more about on-the-ground restrictions in services at the subsector level. And finally, I think comparative work between regions like East Asia and Africa could be very important for informing policy decisions. So if those are my four takeaways, it just remains for me to thank two people that have been particularly important for the presentation of this panel, besides the panel themselves, and I'll come to that in just a minute. First of all, Hugh Cole, I want to introduce you, Hugh. Hugh is the Country Programs Director for the International Growth Center in London. You've got to stand up, Hugh. That's the custom in this place. Amanda Jeanhaj, please stand up, Amanda. Both have been extremely important. Thank you for the round. Both have been extremely important in making this panel a reality. I'd also like you to join.
Actually, since we're, I would like to ask Sally Murray to stand up, who made all my interviews possible in Rwanda.
All right, there you go. And the larger IGC team. That said, perhaps you can join me in thanking what has been a wonderful panel and set of presentations.